108 megapixels on a smartphone camera, 8K video capture, ultra-wide like fisheye, and ultra-zoom until we go to the moon. With dozens of flagship smartphones hitting the market each year, each claiming that their camera is the best, how do you choose? And also, what is a megapixel or OIS? And why do some smartphones have so many cameras? Today, I'm gonna explain to you everything you need to know about the smartphone camera, technically. These days, unless you're a gamer or a geek who cares about things such as processor, RAM, storage, screen refresh rate, network specs, yada yada, nerd, the one standout feature that everybody seems to care about is the camera. And the brands have definitely noticed.
The new dual camera system of iPhone 12.
The most powerful thin camera.
This top of the line camera system.
An incredible pro grade camera.
Now, I don't know about you, but I find myself reaching for my smartphone most of the time when I'm not shooting videos for this channel or for paid gigs. The best camera for you is always gonna be the camera you have with you, and lucky for us, smartphone cameras have come a long way since the early days. But there are still a few key things that you need to know about the camera on a smartphone if you're picking a smartphone primarily for its photo and video taking capabilities. Let me break it down for you. Firstly, let's address the elephant in the room. Megapixels. Let's take a closer look at this image. If you zoom all the way in, you'll see that it's made out of an array of tiny elements called pixels. The mega prefix denotes a million. So putting those two words together form megapixels, which refers to a million picture elements. Instinctively, we would think that a camera with more megapixels is able to capture images with finer details and higher resolution. Therefore, it's going to give us better image quality, right? But why does the camera on an iPhone 12 Pro Max with only 12 megapixels still able to hold its own against the 108 megapixel beast on the Samsung Galaxy S21 Ultra? In fact, take a look at this list of flagship phones that are currently out there, and you'll see that the megapixel count on their main camera actually ranges quite a bit. But why though? Surely every single one of these brands want to fit their flagships with the best camera they can make. So why not just go with 108 megapixels like the Samsung? Unless through research and development, they found that megapixels is not the single determining factor that influences a camera's image quality. Which brings us to the next point. The camera or image sensor. So what is a camera or image sensor? Well, if you've ever seen a mirrorless or DSLR camera without the lens, then you would have seen a digital image sensor. So how does it work? Without risking putting you guys to sleep with a super technical explanation about image sensors, actually leave a comment down below if you actually want us to go more in depth into image sensors. But here's the gist of it. Image sensors are built with an array of light catching photosites, sometimes also confusingly called pixels, much like the one in the image that we showed before. When the shutter is activated, these photosites or pixels will capture light for as long as they are exposed, converting light photons into electrical signals to be processed by the camera's image signal processor. Camera sensors in smartphones work exactly the same way, except instead of having shutters, the image or camera sensor itself will turn on and off as you activate it. Also, they are way smaller. To put things into perspective, most DSLR and mirrorless cameras these days have a full frame, an APS-C or crop sensor, and an even smaller micro four thirds sensor. Of course, you can't forget medium format, which is larger than full frame. I know, it's pretty confusing, but bear with me. Then you have your point and shoots, one of the most popular ones being the RX100 series from Sony, and it has an 1-inch sensor. Smartphones use image sensors that are a little bit smaller than that, with the Mi 11 Ultra having an image sensor closest to 1-inch at 1 over 1.12-inch, the biggest in 2021 so far. I believe I speak for everyone when I say a mirrorless camera with a much bigger sensor objectively takes a higher quality image than a smartphone. But why is that? When it comes to image sensors, does size matter? Yes, absolutely. You see, if you compare two image sensors, say between a mirrorless camera like the Sony A7S III that we're filming on and the iPhone 12 Pro Max that both have 12 megapixels, you will see that not only is the A7S III sensor much bigger, so are the photo sites. In fact, the pixel pitch, sometimes also referred as pixel size, which measures the distance between the center of one pixel or photo site to the center of the next, in the A7S III sensor is 8.4 microns, almost 5 times larger than the 1.7 microns on the iPhone. Similarly, if you compare the 12 megapixel sensor on the iPhone 12 Pro Max to the 108 megapixel sensor on the Samsung S21 Ultra, even with the iPhone sensor's smaller size, you'll find that the actual photo sites are still larger, more than double compared to the 0.8 microns on the Samsung. The size of a photo site or pixel determines its ability to collect light, which in turn dictate the sensor's dynamic range or perceivable steps between light and dark. Also, cramming so many pixels into small sensors would mean that sometimes the light from one pixel can leak into adjacent pixels, causing something we call sensor noise, and is a lot more apparent in low light situations. Which is why the A7S III is able to produce cleaner images with a much bigger dynamic range, retaining more details in the shadows and highlights compared to the iPhone 12 Pro Max, especially in low light situations. But Shane, if pixel size matters so much, why does the Samsung S21 Ultra with its tiny pixel pitch of 0.8 microns, half the size of the iPhone's, still manages to go toe-to-toe with it? Well, some manufacturers like Samsung are navigating this issue by making four adjacent pixels work as one, imitating the traits of having a pixel with twice the pixel pitch. Oh yeah, before I forget, having a large sensor also impacts the focal length, which means that cameras with larger sensors are able to capture images with a much shallower depth of field, creating this creamy isolation between the subject and the background, and also creating something fancy called bokeh, kind of like this. However, even with a smartphone like the Mi 11 Ultra, having an image sensor that is close to 1 inch, producing much more bokeh compared to your usual smartphone, there's still quite a huge gap between that and the RX100 that actually has a 1 inch sensor. But why is that? Well, in front of that 1 inch sensor of the RX100, we have a much larger lens, which greatly increases the focal length, which brings us to our next point. Okay, in front of a smartphone's camera sensor, we have a lens which has a focal length as mentioned before. The focal length refers to the distance between the camera's image sensor and where light converges and focuses the image inside the lens, measured in millimeters. The longer the focal length of a lens, the more punched in or magnified the subject will be. The shorter the focal length, a wider image will be captured with more surrounding. So this maximum area that a camera can capture at any focal length is called the field of view. Let me demonstrate with our trusty A7S III here. This is what you get with a 90mm lens, a very narrow field of view. Now anything above 60mm is considered a telephoto lens. This is what you get with a 28mm lens. The shorter the focal length, the wider the field of view, which is why a lens like this is usually referred to as a wide angle lens. Because of the way smartphones are designed with tiny sensors and a tiny lens very close up to it, the focal length is actually very short, which is why when you see specifications on a smartphone's lens focal length, like the iPhone's 26mm on their main camera, it actually refers to a full frame equivalent. Most flagship smartphones these days come with multiple cameras, usually pairing something like a wide angle main camera with a telephoto and sometimes a third ultra wide angle and sometimes a fourth periscope telephoto like the Samsung S21 Ultra. That's all you need to know about the lens in a smartphone. Let's move on to the next point. Now that we're done talking about the camera module and the front elements, let's talk about the back end, which has seen quite a huge improvement over the years. See, the Google Pixel 5 is still using pretty much the same camera module as the Pixel 2, which came out 4 years ago. Firstly, let's talk about the image signal processor. Like we mentioned before, the image sensor converts light information carried by photons into an electrical signal. This signal then gets processed into a picture by, you guessed it, an image signal processor. Image signal processors carry out a variety of important tasks such as, number one, Ultrawide balance or AWB, which has a bigger impact than you think, verified by MKBHD from years of blind smartphone camera tests. Number two, we have auto exposure or AE, which automatically determines how much light the image sensor gets by adjusting the aperture, shutter speed, and ISO based on brightness information collected by the sensor itself. Then we have autofocus or AF, which is pretty self-explanatory. Then we have demosaicing. We don't have much time to get into it, but it basically deals with color. Number five, we have noise reduction, which gets rid of noise in an image while retaining details, usually with some sort of sharpening. I'm not a big fan of this in most smartphones because they tend to overdo it and give us a very unnatural image, especially in low light. Finally, we have the lens and sensor compensation, which compensates for lens and sensor issues such as vignetting, chromatic aberration, and distortion. That's because smartphones have very tiny sensors with very tiny lenses. Suffice to say that image processing has as much impact on the image quality as the camera module itself. Now, we don't have much time to get into all the technicalities of everything that I talked about just now, so feel free to leave a comment down below if you want me to clarify anything further. Okay, we're almost done. Now let's talk about image stabilization. Smartphones in general are quite light, no matter how heavy you feel they are because you need to hit the gym. Without some form of stabilization, every time you take a photo or video, you're gonna get a lot of camera bumps and shakes. Image stabilization in a smartphone reduces camera shake, thus combating motion blur that is associated to unwanted camera movement, and in turn, improves your image quality. This can be achieved mechanically, OIS, digitally, EIS, or a combination of both. AIS. Optical image stabilization, or OIS, is a mechanical solution that counters camera shake from unsteady hands by moving the image sensor or lens using a gyroscope. Electronic image stabilization, or EIS, is a software post-processing rather than a mechanical function. It digitally crops and warps the image to keep it steady, usually designed to help you capture a more stable video footage. Then there's artificial intelligence stabilization, or AIS, which combines both OIS and EIS and is currently found on Huawei devices. Image stabilization helps bridge the gap between a smartphone camera and a dedicated camera. For instance, it allows us to take images with longer shutter speeds, with longer exposures. This way we can capture a much brighter image in low light settings. Also, it allows us to take more steady video footages for reasons such as vlogging and such. What's not to love? Here are some other somewhat important stuff that you need to know about your smartphone camera. Firstly, we have the aperture, which is expressed in f-numbers. It's the opening between the lens and the sensor. The wider the aperture, the lower the f-number, the more light is allowed to reach the sensor. In a smartphone, you want to get as much light in as possible, so having a wide aperture like f1.8 on the Samsung S21 Ultra's main camera is ideal. Some people might associate a wider aperture with a shallower depth of field, and that is certainly true with something like a mirrorless camera, but because of the tiny sensor and the much shorter focal length on a smartphone, a f2.2 on a smartphone camera only provides a depth of field equivalent to a f13 or 14 aperture on a full frame camera, so that's not a lot. Next, we have zoom. There's optical zoom and digital zoom. To calculate the optical zoom, simply divide the focal length of the telephoto by the focal length of the wide angle of the smartphone. On the iPhone 12 Pro Max, that's 2.5 times, but on the S21 Ultra, you get 10 times of optical zoom, because of that fourth 240mm periscope telephoto camera. Digital zoom is achieved by simply cropping into the image, which gets you a lot more zoom at the expense of image quality. Next, we have HDR, which stands for High Dynamic Range. With HDR, your smartphone will take multiple pictures at different exposure levels, combine them into one to maximize the dynamic range. It can improve images taken with a smartphone, but doesn't look very natural if not done properly. Then we have video quality. And when it comes to video capture on smartphones, you only need to care about the resolution, frame rate, and codec. Codec is important because it determines how easy or difficult it is to edit the footage from your phone. In terms of resolution, most flagship phones these days can take up to 4K and even 8K footage. 4K refers to the 2160p resolution, which is 3840 pixels across, 2160 pixels vertically. That is actually about 8 megapixels, while 8K is 7680 pixels horizontal and 4320 pixels vertically, and corresponds to about 33 megapixels. Frame rate is measured in FPS or frames per second. Movies are usually shown in 24 FPS, which means that there are 24 frames shown per second. Higher frame rates lead to a smoother looking video with less motion blur. Sometimes you can also find extremely high frame rates, such as the 1920 FPS on the Xiaomi Mi Ultra 11, which can be slowed down to create slow motion videos. Image quality with smartphone slow-mo is usually pretty meh, because you need to flood the sensor with a lot of light in order to keep up with the high frame rate. But hey, it's still a good time. So in conclusion, do megapixels matter in a smartphone? Yes, but it's not the only factor that will determine its image quality. For that, check out all the other stuff that we discussed just now. You know, and if it's all too confusing for you, do remember that you can always subscribe to Mob House, because next time we review a smartphone with a camera, I'll tell you if it's good or not. See? So good, right? If you thought this video was awesome, don't forget to like and share. Also, leave a comment down below to let us know what smartphone you're using and if you are actually satisfied with the camera quality. I would like to know. And also, don't forget to subscribe to our YouTube channel and hit the notification bell to see more content like this. And follow us on Facebook and Instagram to see more shenanigans from the Mob House crew. And I will see you after the comment section. It's time for the comments! And firstly, we have the video on YouTube, which is the best budget TWS earbuds under 69 ringgit or 1669 US dollars. Firstly, we have Sol Hin. Shane bila PKP tiga kali jadi gini lah. Correct, because MCO until my hair looking like a lion's mane. Chi Weng said that the Xiaomi earbuds look the best among them all, not gonna lie. It's true, it looks the best, but it's not the most functional or sound the best. But I think the build quality is the best. Azwan Fear No More said that your video quality always blow my mind. Hope that Mr. Bangsawan can create more content for budget audiophile earphones. Can, exactly. That's why the day I did that post to ask you guys what budget you guys actually have. So I'm gonna do more earphones and headphones reviews real soon. Project Mind Game Dengan Dama said that he's gonna get a ZNT for his sister's birthday next month. If she said no good, I'll find me. Come and find me. You know why? Then I can give you suggestions for your sister to get her ears checked. James Mendoza says that he loves wired earphones, but after watching this video, he's so convinced he's gonna check these pods out. Bro, check it out, especially the ZNT, highly recommended. Finally, we have MGAG Senpai that come here and then says, AirPod users, right earphone, left earphone. Walao, you are. That's all the time we have for this week's comment section. If you want to see your comment featured, right, leave a comment down below. Not like you have anything better to do anyways now that MCO has been extended. And I will see you guys in the next one.